Let us prepare our hearts for worship this morning. Let us pray. Lord God, our Father, we are grateful and we rejoice this morning because of all that you have done in Jesus Christ and for Jesus Christ, raising him from the dead so that we too may have new life. And so we come to you this morning. We want to give you thanks. We want to come with grateful hearts. And so let me invite us to begin this morning with gratitude. Many of us would have followed Lenten devotions, whether it's the meditations or whether it's other resources. And so through these weeks of Lent, as we look back, what are some things for which you are grateful? What are some things that God has graced you with, gifted you with? Even as we take time to give thanks, to look back over the season of Lent, there may have been things that we have struggled with. There may have been circumstances of life which we have encountered that may have been difficult or dark. And so allow me to invite us to entrust these things to God's hands. Even as we acknowledge these circumstances, even as we look at these circumstances, we also want to look at the cross and the empty tomb and know that God is able to hold these things and us in his hands. And so we continue to keep our eyes on the Lord God, even as we worship him as his people this morning.
We welcome to those who are watching from the homes for this Easter service. We would like to remind those who have not taken their communion pack to take it so that when we have communion, we could all participate together. Will the congregation please rise for the call to worship? Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed from the dead and the first of the sleepers. Let us pray together. God of hope, in the midst of death, you call forth life. When all hope seemed gone, you raised Jesus from the grave. We come before you today, longing for your life-giving presence. God of new life, raise us up with all your people. Lift us from the tombs of our despair and doubt, that we may rejoice in your power over death. God of joy, fill our hearts with alleluias as we sing your praises. Glory to God. Amen.
Hallelujah. Jesus is alive. Shall we sing out loud? Jesus is alive. Amen. Hallelujah. hands together.
Our sin is broken, we have perfect liberty. The Lamb of God is risen, He's alive, He's alive. Hallelujah, Jesus is alive. Lost its victory, and the grave has been denied.
Jesus lives forever.
Jesus lives forever. He's alive. He's alive. He's the end. The first and last is He. The curse of sin is broken. We have perfect liberty.
The Lamb of God has risen.
He's alive. He's alive. Hallelujah. Jesus is alive. God has lost his victory, and the grave has been denied.
Jesus lives forever.
He's alive, He's alive, He's the Alpha and Omega, the first and last is He. The curse of sin is broken, we have perfect liberty, liberty. The Lamb of God is risen, He's alive. He's alive. Hallelujah. Jesus is alive.
Yes, hallelujah. Jesus is alive. Let's give him all praise and all glory. For he deserves all our praises and our glory. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord. Truly, Lord, you give your life for all mankind, Lord, that we can have this eternal life, O Father God. Lord, this is really unconditional, O Father God. And Lord, thank you, Lord, once again, Lord. We want to praise you. We want to glorify you.
Father,
him to the tree. Oh, the broader cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. So my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Now my gap is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son set free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus gave. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son set free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, the broader cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor to thee. See, the stone is rolled away, behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah, God be praised, who's risen from the cross, my salvation, may your love pour out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto me.
Let's sing out.
Oh, the broader cross, my salvation, may your love pour out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Oh, the rugged cross, my salvation, may your love pour out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Praise and honor unto thee. Praise and honor unto thee. Sins and death.
Your name is lifted high, Lord.
Your name is lifted high and great. Every demon's spirit in power always trembles when your name is heard.
And be your church.
Trembles that victory in your world. Oh, the glory of your name, the splendors of your name, none can compare with the power of your name. You are Jesus,
The sister sing now.
You have triumphs over sins and
yes, Father. Your triumph over sins and death, Lord. You are just wonderful, Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. We give you glory and praise. Hallelujah. Let's sing, brothers.
Every demon spirit in hell always trembles when your name is heard, and be your church, and be your church, shambles that victory in the world.
Let's sing together.
Oh, the glory of your name, the splendors of your name, none can compare with the power of your name. You are Jesus, you are Lord, you are God.
Oh, the glory of the name, Lord.
Oh, the glory of your name, the splendor of your name. None can compare with the power of your name. You are Jesus, you are Lord, you are God. Splendors of your name, none can compare with the power of your name. You are Jesus, you are Lord, you are God.
You are Jesus,
you are Lord, you are God.
Yes, Father. You are Jesus, you are Lord, you are God. Nothing can compare to your great name, O Father. For Lord, there's no other God that died for us. Only you and you alone, O Father God, is our God, is our King. We want to declare your majesty in this place. Lord, we give you all glory, O Father God. Thank you once again. You have truly risen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
As Easter people, let us pray this responsively. Sing aloud, O mother and sons, fathers and daughters, sisters and brothers. Rejoice and exult with all your hearts. Let us offer our prayers and thanksgiving with one voice, calling out the good news. We look for our Savior among the living.
Jesus Christ is alive.
We pray for all faithful people, for every human soul that turns to God in longing and in love. Today and every day, pull us out of our graves and into your life. We look for our Savior, Redeemer among the living. We pray for nations of the earth, for those in authority and those under authority. Where I have the pauses, please name the nations in your prayer. From the four winds, O breath of life, and we shall live together in peace. We look for our mediator among the living. We pray for this world, our garden home, for the rain and the snow, the seed and the sprout, for the birthing room and the last place of rest, for every new creation. We look for the gardener among the living. We pray for those who are sick or suffering, for anyone who needs extra help just now. We pray specifically for those named here today, aloud and in our hearts. Living Lord, renew them in your love. We look for a sustainer among the living. We pray for those who have died and for all who mourn. We pray especially for those named here today, aloud and in our hearts. Eternal One, bring them home and gather them in. We look for our beloved among the living. With drinks for the triumph of life over death, offering special thanks for those joys, sorrows, challenges, and delights named here today, aloud and in our hearts. We are amazed at what has happened. We look for our Creator among the living. Holy One, even before we call, you answer. While we are yet speaking, you hear. We offer up these prayers in the name of the risen Christ, our Savior, Redeemer, and Friend. Amen.
Acts chapter 10, verse 34 to 43. So Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people, and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him, all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. John chapter 20, verse 1 to 18. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloth lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloth lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus. Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloth, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had laid, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you had carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. This is the word of God.
Christ is risen. Shall we try that again? The response to Christ is risen is, Christ is risen indeed. Let's try that. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for your mighty work in Jesus Christ, raising him from the dead, so that all of us may have new life in Christ and be brought back to you. We thank you and we pray that we may celebrate with joy today. We ask this in Jesus' name. What do you do when you face a situation where it feels like your whole world has collapsed? What do you do when all your hopes are dashed and the days ahead of you look darker than anything you have ever experienced? You had dreams and you had hopes. And those dreams and hopes that seemed so sure of coming true, and then suddenly the rug was pulled from under your feet. What do you do?
For Jesus' followers, that was what the day after Jesus' death felt like. There was nothing they could do, not even go to the tomb, for it was worth waiting. Is an act of trust, and in many instances, an act of love. Mary Magdalene and the disciples had followed Jesus for a while now, and they had experienced life with him. They had come to know him. Well, perhaps not completely, but they knew him well enough, perhaps. And Jesus had given them hope. He gave them life. He introduced God to them in a way that they had never experienced before. And he had taught them things about the kingdom of God that they did not always understand. But somehow, whenever he spoke, there was this beginning, the budding of hope in their hearts. The hope that God would one day reign over his people once again, and they would worship him and come so close to him as their forefathers had. Mary Magdalene had been delivered from 7 demons by Jesus. The darkness in being oppressed by those demons had been so bad. But the darkness she now experienced in Jesus' death seemed even darker. And yet, for some reason she could not explain, it did not have that same oppression that she had. It was the Sabbath, and so Mary, along with the others, observed the Sabbath ritual. They lit candles, as is the practice, but somehow the light of those candles could not lighten the darkness that she and the others felt. They sang the song of welcome to the angels bringing peace, as was usual. But in her mind, were they really present? She did not feel peace. She did not feel at rest. And so it was with the other ladies as well. And so very early the next morning, even before the sun was up, they had risen, these women. They took the spices that they had prepared after sundown the previous day and were already on their way to the tomb. Jesus' body, taken down from the cross late in the day, had only been hastily prepared to be entombed and just laid in that tomb. Now, the women intended to do that job properly. It was a risk because touching a corpse meant that they would be unclean, and this was the season of Passover. But it was an act of utter devotion on their part. John's account that we just heard read to us mentions only Mary Magdalene as the woman. But in her reporting to the disciples about Jesus' missing body, you know, she says we, and so we assume that the other ladies were with her too. It was a shock for them to discover the stone rolled away and Jesus' body missing. Grave robbers, their first thought. Desecration. And so they rush back, and Mary gasps out the news to Peter and to the other disciples. But Mary was not about to let it go. In Cantonese, we say, "Kam yin." And so she returned to the tomb. And there, confused, not knowing what to do, she did the only thing she could. She wept for her teacher. It had seemed that there were no more tears, but then they came. But something in her was still not satisfied. She had to make sure, and so she stooped and looked into the tomb. And for a moment, it seemed to her that the tomb was not as dark as it was in the morning earlier. And then she saw the two of them, angels. Were they the ones she had wondered about when they sang that Sabbath song to welcome angels bringing peace? And now they were asking her about her tears. Why are you weeping? Could they not see her beloved teacher, whose body had lain there, was no longer there? She moves her head out of the tomb, the door of the tomb, sensing someone behind her. The gardener, of course, he would know. But before she can say anything, he speaks first, asking her like the angels did about her tears. And so she says it again, the body that was there, if you have taken it away, tell me where it is, and I'll take it away, as if that body had been a bother to this man. When we look at that scene, and as I look at it, I wonder, did Jesus smile at Mary's words and emotions such that she thought that she would be able to take that body away by herself? And if we stop to continue looking at that scene and take in what is going on, we would see, we would perhaps sense Mary's deep devotion to her Lord. And I am sure Jesus saw it so clearly. And so now, earlier he had called her woman. Now, seeing her devotion, he calls her by name, Mary. And she knew that voice. She had heard it call her name so many times before. Rabuni, my teacher, was her answer. And she falls at his feet, clings to him. She was not about to lose him again. But Jesus gently reassures her that he is indeed alive and he will be around for some time yet. I'm not ascending to my Father just yet. And this encounter and subsequent encounters with the risen Christ would renew her, and she would come to experience Jesus' presence in a new way, in a deeper way. The disciples, they too had grown in their understanding and relationship with Jesus, but there was still more to come. And so Peter and the other disciple, many believe is John, are the ones to whom Mary runs to tell the news of the empty tomb. And both of them, one older, the other perhaps the youngest of the whole bunch of them, are regarded more or less as leaders of the disciples. And so hearing the news, the two of them take off for the tomb to verify what they had been told. And while they had come to know Jesus, and the two of them were among the three, together with James, the closest to Jesus, they still had their own ideas, their own expectations of Jesus and who he was, what he was to do. And so, like for the others, their ideas, their expectations had been shattered. But now, as they race to the tomb to look, they are puzzled. When we look at the initial reactions of the disciples and the women, when they first encountered the empty tomb, it was not one of joy. It was one of confusion, of doubt, and of fear. No one had risen from the dead before. True, the disciples had seen Jesus raise the little girl from the dead, and Lazarus, and even the son of the widow in Nain. But then it was Jesus who was raising them from the dead, but now Jesus himself was dead, at least. That was how they had seen him last, his lifeless body being taken down from the tomb. The two men, Nicodemus, Joseph of Arimathea, hastily dressing the body and then laying it in the tomb, and the stone rolled over, sealing it in. That was the last they had seen. And so as the other disciple reaches the tomb, he kind of looks inside and sees the situation, and then Peter runs in and heads straight into the tomb. The other disciple then looks again, and as he surveys that rock, that bed where Jesus' body had lay, and saw the arrangement of the linen, the headcloth, something jogs his memory. Didn't Jesus say? And as these inklings begin, John says he believed. And yet, the disciples not get the full picture. John kind of tells us, like a whispered aside, we weren't there yet. And they had not quite connected what had taken place with what Scripture said. The disciples had begun getting to know Jesus through being with him, traveling with him, staying with him, joining in him in his work and in his ministry. And then, just like that, he was taken away from them. And now, having risen, and they would soon encounter Jesus, they would experience and come to know Jesus in a new way, like Mary Magdalene would. Their belief in Jesus and their trust in him would grow in the coming months as the Holy Spirit would teach them and bring home to them Jesus' teachings, and they would begin and continue to live what Jesus had taught them. And so the result of their encounters with the risen Christ would lead the disciples and the other followers to proclaim Jesus, to proclaim that he is risen, that Jesus is indeed the one sent by God, and above all, that Jesus is Lord. At the same time, it was kind of like learning on the job. They still had to learn fully God's purposes and plans. And so if you remember in Matthew tells us, Jesus says, go make disciples of all nations. And when Jesus said that, he really meant all nations, every single nation, including the Gentiles. And the Gentiles would not have to first convert to Judaism to become followers of Jesus Christ, as it was at that time. If Gentiles wanted to believe and worship Yahweh, the living God, they had to become Jews first. But Jesus was not saying this. No such thing. And so Peter had to find that out firsthand. And as I look at what Peter went through, I can't help but smile. It was like Jesus saying, Peter, you got things to learn. Let me show you. And so the Lord gave him a vision. If we read a little bit before today's text, the Lord had to give him a vision and then give him a call to go drop in on Cornelius. Thankfully, by now, Peter knew the Lord well enough to obey without a lot of questioning. And the result of that was that Peter had a ringside seat to what God was doing, because up to that point, Peter had not even considered that these people were to be included in God's kingdom without becoming Jews. And so Peter's proclamation, which we heard read to us, told them who Jesus is, what Jesus did, and what took place with Jesus' death and resurrection, and that Jesus is the judge of the living and the dead. And so if we want a pattern to proclaim Christ, there it is for you. Who is Jesus? What did Jesus do? Not so long ago, but also in your life today. What happened with Jesus' death and resurrection? And that Jesus will come to judge the living and the dead. And while it is not in today's reading, if we continue reading from today's text, as Peter spoke, the Holy Spirit came upon Cornelius and his household, almost as if, okay, you have told them enough. Here, the Holy Spirit, the very same way that the Holy Spirit came upon Peter and the other disciples, it was God's signal that Jesus did mean all, every one of the nations in the world, not just the Jews, not just the Jews and the Samaritans, but truly all from every nation who are able to hear and put their trust in Jesus. And so Mary, like Mary, like the disciples, like Cornelius, this life we receive, we can do nothing to generate this life. We can only receive because God gives if we open our hearts to Jesus. And this life is the resurrection life. You and I do nothing to earn it. We cannot earn it. We can only receive it. And so what does this resurrection life look like? Firstly, the resurrection life is a life of wonder and awe. We were made for worship. Whether we like it or not, all of us worship. And so we were made to know wonder. We were made to know awe. And we stand before the cross that is now empty and before the tomb that is equally empty. The empty cross, the place where sin and the powers of darkness, which would usurp the place of the Lord, have been defeated completely. The empty tomb, the symbol of victory over death, taking away the sting for those who believe. And so we give ourselves to worship the Lord who brought it to pass. The resurrection life is a life of worship. Secondly, the resurrection life is life with God. Jesus, with his death and resurrection, has bridged that chasm between us and God. And like Cornelius, God accepts us as we are, opening us to the fullness of life that we were created to live, life with God. Thirdly, the resurrection life is life with God as our Heavenly Father. Jesus made it possible for this to happen, for us to have God as our Father and to receive his lavish love when we say yes to God. We do need to say that yes first. And we are invited, like Jesus did, to live in that love, in that intimacy with God as Father. It's for all of us to come to him, to open our hearts to him. Fourth, the resurrection life is a life of immersing ourselves in the scriptures, to read them, to study them, to meditate on them, to memorize them and more. And when we engage with scripture that way, we will come to encounter the risen Lord, the God who loves us immensely, who loves us extremely, and to grow in the knowledge of God in experience. It's not just intellectual knowledge, but we come into that experience of God. And finally, the resurrection life is a life that proclaims Jesus, that proclaims the glory of the cross and the empty tomb and all that they stand for. And so like Peter, we are commissioned, not just called, commissioned to go proclaim the risen Lord. But first, you and I must be captured by that wonder and awe. We must experience the risen Lord Jesus like Mary and the first disciples did, to be able to tell who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. And so as we celebrate Easter today, and for the next 7 weeks, Easter is not just one day. It lasts for 7 weeks, the great 50 days until Pentecost. Let us not only just know that Jesus died for our sins in a clinical way. We tend to do that. Oh yeah, Jesus died for our sins. But let us come to experience deeply, day by day, God's great love for us. Let us come to grow into the resurrection life that is offered to us. And as we do that, let us go proclaim Christ to all. Let us pray. Lord God, our Father, we thank you that you have come to us and that you reached out to us, taking the initiative to break the bonds of sin with Jesus' sacrifice on the cross and the resurrection on the third day. And so, Lord, we pray, teach us to receive this life deeply and live it to the full, rejoicing and worshiping you day after day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And finally, the soul training. Let me invite us to take some time, to make time this coming week, to take a good look at the cross that is empty, and the tomb that is empty. See in these two God's love for us and revel in that love, relish that love, receive that love. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. And so the key verses, let me invite us to say this together. And he commanded them to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness through sin through his name. And the song of response, he is risen. Let's try this.
Sending off sharp warning. the sun's dim up, amazing look inside a voice, an angel most invited me, afraid he is alive.
Christ is risen. And so this morning, welcome once again to Wesley Seremban, and welcome to all those who are joining us from wherever you are online. And just a couple of things to bring to your notice. Please take note of the announcements that are in the bulletin. You would have received it. The local preacher's license, the ICM programs, and of course, please note the SOPs, yeah? We would want to encourage us, as soon as service is ended, to please leave, and if you would like to chit-chat, do adjourn to a place where it is more feasible to do that, yeah? We would also want to request that if you have paid your pledge, please look for your receipt. The receipts are there. They're kind of piling up. So if you could just please go take a look at the brown envelopes on the table outside. Today is Easter Sunday. The Methodist women, and we say thank you to them, have prepared Easter eggs for all of us. I have been instructed to tell you that they have used edible dye, yeah, to dye the cakes, eggs, sorry. Sorry for those who are at home, it's only for those who are present here. And so also a reminder that our gifts and pledges and offerings will be received as we exit the church later.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Earth and heaven chorus say.
And so receive the benediction. We do this responsively today. We have come from darkness and despair to hope and joy. We have come from the darkness and despair to hope and joy.
We have been transformed by the light.
Go forth to witness and to testify to the message of hope we have received this day. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be our loved ones, now and always. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated once again. Happy Easter to everyone. Have a good week ahead. God bless. See you next week.